12 years ago, I made my first architecture portfolio and I thought it was amazing. Today, we're gonna see if that holds up and what I would do differently now using the same framework that I teach today. So let's start with the cover and the first impression pages. At that time, I was really into green as a main color for everything and also into creating a collage and scanning my sketchbook drawings into it. So basically, I grabbed my most interesting sketches at the time, which I know maybe not the most interesting right now, and overlaid them onto a cover where I just placed the portfolio title towards the bottom, along with a ton of free Photoshop brushes that I had downloaded at that moment. I really liked this cover back then, and I kind of still like it now. I think it speaks a lot about how I was still a student, and I had some very specific tastes. And there was this grungy paper texture that also gave it a more printed vibe onto everything. So probably an easy fix on the cover would have been lowering the opacity on certain elements that I didn't really think were adding to the conversation, like for example, this tire, the human here, and some text, and probably just making one sketch more relevant than all the others. Now, as soon as we open the portfolio, you can see the table of contents, a general contact area, and a huge picture of me, So yeah, this is completely something that I would not do today at all. I think adding a picture of you can be a risky decision. And if I was to add it today, I would probably make it a picture that can add a bit more context into something related to architecture, like giving a conference or sketching, I don't know, something else, something that maybe looks a little bit more professional. But this picture seems like something I also uploaded as a Facebook profile pic at that time. So no, I don't think it works for this portfolio. Apart from that, I really like how I try to structure the table of contents. So there was an intention to have a clear hierarchy of title, subtitle, and content. The bad thing is that in this portfolio, there are no professional projects because I was still in school, obviously. And for adding things like basic info, CV, and three more projects, there is really no need to add the same page number here. So today, I would have simplified this so much more. Also, I would have not used so many figure overlays and geometric brushes like these, but I guess this is part of what I liked at that moment, so it's understandable. Then for the CV, you can see again that I was trying to fill everything out with as much info as possible so it can look like, whoa, I have done a lot of things for just being a student. But when inspecting it up close, there's a lot of unused space. Like for example, the graphic bars here that indicate the software knowledge can be really hard to understand, and the regular text alignment makes it look kind of unprofessional. Although I really like the intention of a hierarchical structure of green titles with a slight gray body, everything could be less complicated to read. Kind of something like this. But okay, enough with the first impression. Let's go on to our first project spreads. So one thing I really liked about this portfolio is that there's a chapter indicator that was supposed to separate academic projects from professional ones. And in this case, the cover image in an extended format served the purpose to create this separation. And also, I think it looked really cool at the time. It created a continuity between the cover and the inside of the portfolio. Now for this first project, which has these two spreads, one introduction spread with the project title, info, general diagrams and renders, and a second content spread with some sections and an aerial render. One quick fix I would have had is more white space and breathing room. Like, so either making everything much, much smaller and leaving some white space for everything to breathe, and also erasing unnecessary elements. Like for example, the big text here and this one here as well as these gray rectangles in the introduction. This would have made it look so much better. Now, as for the second spread, I think it's really interesting and risky that there's a black page spread that fades into a day render. Again, it looks too crammed and the section has really no technical information at all. So just adding some text, maybe a human figure, can change the drawing as well as probably reducing the size of some text and made it look much, much better. It's kind of something like this. Now for the second project, there's again an abusive relationship with the lack of white space. I think that was my personality at the time. I like to cram a lot of things in, and my obsession with overlaying a bunch of things over a render was getting out of hand, as you can see. I think a simple solution to all of this was either reducing the size of the render and leaving more white space, or increasing the render and overlaying everything on top. For the second spread, I really liked how there was a dark render paired along with some black background and white plants, but then again, the level of quality for the plants is extremely low, and more than anything, I would go back and include drawings that are technically proficient and just drawn right. Now, this is one of the projects I like the most from the whole portfolio. So much so that if I had to do it again, I would include this project as my first project and not leave it buried in the middle for someone to probably not look at it. The second spread of this project, honestly, this one still holds up from my point of view, where I use this main night render as the one that set the general mood of this spread. Then with the same color of the sky, or at least a very similar color tone, I added a background in the first page and added the facade elevations in a more illustrative type of perspective, which I thought was really cool. So if I had the chance to go back to the spread, probably I would correct very minor things, like for example, the tone, the intensity of the elevation, the inconsistency of the typography, and just adding a bit more contrast in certain areas. But overall, this is one of those spreads that I feel really proud of. Even today, I think it looks really good and it holds up. And after this, I didn't add any more projects in a structured manner. So I just added some renders and images of some competitions that I had done until then that I really liked and thought would be interesting to add. At that moment, I had an obsession with overdoing things with Photoshop. So I would export like a line drawing from SketchUp and inside of Photoshop, try to render it as best as possible by putting textures, people, overlays, and a lot of color correction. The general layout of these pages don't follow the same rules or aesthetic that I set out to design on the first spreads. These are just full bleed images with little to no information. So in the future, probably I would have added some text to maybe tell the viewer what they were looking at and what was my role in all of this. So looking at the portfolio in its entirety, I really like how there's a character and a spirit to stick to certain colors, to certain fonts and ideas. I think that whether I like it or not today, this helped me stand out from the crowd. I create something that I related to at that moment. And when compared to my future portfolios or my current portfolios, it will always stand out in a certain way. So overall, I would just go back and correct minor things like typography, white space, alignment, and building a base for the portfolio, like a readable font, some margins and layouts would have gone a long way with this portfolio. So by now you're probably thinking, okay, Steven, so how did you jump from curating these kinds of portfolios, which have a lot of things to correct and could be much better, to these types of portfolio spreads that look much better, much more organized, and much more tidy? Well, as any story, it really depends on how you tell it. And between my first portfolio and my most recent one, there were a lot of different portfolios that I had to create through the years that helped me improve incrementally. Like for example, this portfolio, the portfolio that I had as a recent graduate of architecture in 2015, when I was looking for a job and sent out this portfolio to a ton of different offices. So I won't go too in depth on this one. Maybe if you guys want a separate video on this one, I can create one. So I'll just scroll through it and show you like the general portfolio. One of the things I really liked about this portfolio was the concept around it. I remember I was in a moment professionally where I was interested in showing the versatility of my work and also conceptualizing my work in a way that made it seem more profound than it actually was, which in architecture can be a really good thing because that's basically using storytelling to your advantage in your portfolio. So for example, I didn't name my portfolio as everyone else's, like with the title of portfolio or my actual name, but instead I named it Kaleidoscope, and I included an image of different rock variations that were an analogy to how I saw my work at that time, like a kaleidoscope of different architectures. Then when you went inside of the portfolio, you could see a table of contents, and for each project, there was a project introduction that had a page logo, title, and basic info, and then different spreads that had images, drawings, text, etc. But something I do remember from that time is that whenever I went into an interview for a job position, everyone always ended up talking and asking me about this cover and about this concept for my portfolio that I created more than the actual projects themselves. And many of them really liked the approach and explicitly said that it showed much more than individual projects, but I showed my personality and ideas as an architect. So some things I would change if I had to redo this portfolio all over again was, first of all, removing this background grungy paper texture that was just too much and created some unnecessary attention in the portfolio, and probably I would just leave it at an off-white beige kind of color. And second, I didn't create a book or portfolio style division to the portfolio at the time. So if you can see, it just looks like PowerPoint presentation slides, but it doesn't give that illusion that it was designed as a book. So I would revisit some pages and try to create a clearer division between each page. And between these two portfolios, you can really see two different versions of me as an architect. And I think that's something that every architect should be able to look back on in a proud way. So if you're watching the video up to this point, I really encourage you to look back on your work. It may feel a little bit embarrassing at first. I mean, trust me, I really hesitated to put this video out there because I know that this is not the best work that I have done. But also I know that because I can look back on it all, I can see how much I've grown and what things I can still improve on. So if you can, look back on your work. And if you're just starting out and you feel your work is not good enough, don't worry, you'll eventually get there. But you have to pass through the storm of bad work to eventually get to the good one. I mean, no one nails their portfolio in the first try. That's just not how it works. Now, if you don't know where to start, I have a playlist that is all about portfolios, portfolio reviews, and portfolio tutorials. So check it out just in case you haven't yet. And also, according to my YouTube stats, the majority of you that watch these videos have not subscribed yet. So just click on the subscribe button and the like button. If you want to see more videos like these where I review my past work, like my portfolio, competition, and different projects, comment down below. Thank you all for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.